All right, what is up, guys? Today, I'm gonna give you the secret to lower lats. As my air quotes will show you, depending on your definition of lower lat, that may or may not actually exist. So what I'm gonna go through today is a couple things that you can think about when training lats, kind of clarify a little bit what the hell is meant by lower lats. Make sure you have an accurate definition of what that means, and then kind of show you some things as far as can you actually make training decisions, do something different with your body when you're performing exercises to actually target your lower lats. So it's pretty accurate to say that the lat is kind of a fan-shaped muscle. Fan-shaped muscle, similar to your pec, it has one really common insertion. So basically all of your lat fibers come together and they insert in your upper arm, again, at one small little tendon attaching it to your humerus. And they have a broad origin, which means they don't have one little point that it attaches to. So literally there's some of these upper fibers of the lats that basically attach kind of to mid upper back, eventually getting towards your spine. And then there's some of your lower lats that attach much lower. So that fascia actually attaches down and shares fascia with stuff, even like your glutes down by your hips. So if by lower lats you mean there is this upper division of lats, the same way there is some upper division of your pec fibers, and by lower lats you mean some of these ones that have these lower insertions of the origin, the lower origin attachment, then technically I don't think it's inaccurate to say there is a lower lat. I think when some people say lower lats, they mean, can I really target this part of my lat? And where if I drew this connecting up all these same fibers as opposed to this upper portion here? While there's a little bit of research that shows, you know, some things can make muscles grow longer, some things can make muscles grow wider, some things can affect the middle of the muscle or the extreme lengths, the origin insertion of the muscle, I don't think there's actually anything that you can really do from a drastic visual development standpoint that's actually worth chasing. So meaning, can I make this grow more than this, more than this? From a thing that makes a difference in aesthetics, in my opinion, no. Can you bias potentially more these upper fibers? So again, the upper fibers of your lat, especially depending on how your upper arm is sitting, some of them run a little bit more horizontal and some of them run a little bit more vertical. Can you bias those? Maybe a teeny bit, in my opinion, but in reality, probably not a huge drastic amount. And it's actually gonna be a little bit positional dependent. Because again, you're gonna have to think about this one for a minute. Some of the things that occur in our body are just a matter of semantics, right? So again, our pec is a fan-shaped muscle, and I think it is worth trying to chase, can I actually bias these lower fibers? Can I bias these upper fibers? The reason that you can so easily bias upper and lower in pecs is because your arm moves in front of your body. If our lat could actually, or if our upper arm could actually wrap around significantly behind our body the same way that it does in front, then you could probably bias lats more, upper or lower. But because most of the time it involves moving your upper arm in front of the body, I don't think it makes that big of a difference. And so all I mean by that is when your arm is stretched up, so when your arm is over the side, it's literally even more so than the muscle belly itself, really how that tendon crosses over the joint that's gonna influence what can be biased over one muscle position or one muscle area section of, again, these upper fibers or these lower fibers. Comparatively. And so again, if it's one little small common insertion tendon, there's not really gonna be that big of a difference between where these upper fibers attach to that tendon and these lower fibers attach. Now again, when your arm comes closer and closer to your side, I would argue maybe that can make a slight difference as far as am I having intent of my upper arm moving back and around, or am I having intent of my upper arm moving down? So that's one thing, and I'm gonna use Cody in a minute to kind of demonstrate that and maybe say, okay, here's some of these little cues that maybe you can think about when you're rowing for lats or doing pull downs for lats. But the reality is most people when they say, you know, oh, I did this exercise and I felt my lower lat, arguably you just felt your lat. So for most people, I think the goal should be able to find your lats, use the lats as opposed to other things that can do very similar things. So lots of muscles can extend your arm in some capacity. So your rear delt, which I didn't even draw on here, can do this. There's a reason that basically your teres is actually called the little lat. There's some other rotator cuff muscles that can move your upper arm, can do something very similar, but only your lat completely crosses over your scapula and attaches to the upper arm. So the big difference, which again, I'll demo in a minute, is as your lat contracts, it can move your entire upper arm and your entire scapula, where a lot of the rotator cuff stuff's all attached to the scapula. And so again, if something just attaches from scapula to humerus, The only thing it can do is move the humerus relative to the scapula. It can't move the entire scapula or shoulder blade at the same time. And so again, that sounds like a lot. Maybe replay that back a couple times and think about that a little bit. But again, just realize because the lat completely crosses over multiple joints, crosses over your scapula, so it can move your scapula and attaches to the upper arm. It can move the humerus, which in turn can move the scapula, where a bunch of those rotator cuffs, rear delt stuff, can only move your upper arm relative to the scapula, can't actually move the scapula itself. So if we kind of think about that and put that all together, hopefully I'll give you guys a couple things to think about. But the short take home is, in reality, if you're doing pull down type motions, I think really all the parts of your lat can really work pretty well. And maybe as you come into the finish of a motion, finish of a pull down, finish of a row, maybe you can bias a little bit more kind of upper fibers of lat versus lower fibers of lat. But the big thing is I'm just gonna give you guys some tips and things to think about to actually bias your lats, make sure your lats are working, as opposed again to using rotator cuff stuff or use rear delt stuff. All right, guys, so using Cody here, we're gonna use his meaty old lat here and hopefully try and demonstrate some stuff. So I'm gonna go through two things here. First tips I'm gonna give are hopefully how can you actually use your lats, most importantly, to start a motion, so to start a pull down or to start a row. And then if you're going to finish a motion, how can you keep that on your lats? And again, not the other stuff, not teres, not rear delts. And then I'm gonna give a little bit of an asterisk, kind of, I said 1 point, 2 points, 3 points, however many points I'm on here. At the end, I'm gonna show again, maybe as you're finishing a motion, whether it's a pull down or a row, maybe bias different portions of the lat. But most of the stuff I think is gonna be to help just find your lat, and again, not use that other upper back stuff. So the first thing is let's say hypothetically we're doing a pull down type motion. Let's get you a little bit more over here. If obviously this is why I wanted to use Cody, you can see this big old meat of the lat here. So just imagine if this muscle contracts, just think about again, if I always say whatever helps you, whatever analogy is, imagine that lat and its insertion is just my hand grabbing his upper arm here. And so again, if I'm pulling my upper arm this way, if I'm pulling with my hand this way, what's gonna move? It can pull all of this down. So his shoulder can rise up. If I pull down from here, it can pull every single thing down because it's pulling down to here. So what I want you guys to see there is, yes, his upper arm is moving down. It can continue to pull down, but also his whole shoulder blade is pulling down. Where again, if I'm using some other muscle, so I'm using his rear delt, if I'm using his teres, which attaches to the scapula here and doesn't attach down here, then basically the only thing I can move is his upper arm. Those muscles can't move the scapula. So a big thing is when you're starting with a lat pull down, again, realize that your lat can pull all of this down. So again, you still want to focus on it, pulling the humerus, pulling it down. But if you're contracting with your lat, if you let that scapula up, which I think you should at the end of the range of motion of a pull down, if you actually contract with your lat, you're going to pull your whole upper arm down and you're going to pull your scapula down at the same time. Whereas if you're contracting just with upper back stuff, rotator cuff stuff, rear delt stuff, very often just your upper arm is going to be moving. All right. So again, that's a subtle thing to think about, but when you're doing your pull downs, realize, am I just doing this upper arm thing? Or if my whole lat is working, am I maybe pulling down my entire upper arm? And again, my scapula is coming along the ride as well too. So that's one is big whenever you're initiating, both with pull downs and also with rows. If you're coming out of a row, the same thing. Realize if the lat pulls down, there's always gonna be this down component as you initiate the row. Whereas if you're just doing upper back stuff or your delt stuff, it's gonna be more this straight back type thing. So again, if you're initiating a row more for upper back, this can be great. But if you're initiating it and the row is more for lat design, realize there's always gonna be this pulling down to here component. So that's one thing when you're initiating both the start of a pull down, the start of a row, make sure that again, there's always this down component and really try and obviously feel that tissue pulling in this direction. I always joke, imagine you've got a bullseye right at the base of your spine here. If Cody has a tramp stamp, which he might, I'm not gonna show his lower back, no judgment. But imagine if you've got that tramp stamp, Cody has a tramp stamp here that says I heart muscles, then you wanna feel like that is your target for your upper arm and everything pulling back and down and around here. Now, the other thing to think to finish is again, as we come into the side. So let's say two things we wanna think about here as we're finishing. First is how do we keep it on the lats? Realize the lats all pull this way. So as you finish a row, as you finish a pull down, this is the direction stuff pulls. Your lats can't pull this way. So again, if I turn a little bit more to the side, if I keep going further and further and further and further back, the only thing that really has an advantage to pull here is rear delt. So that's a big thing. When you finish your pull downs, when you finish your rows, I always say imagine this kind of wrappy, roundy component type thing. So this elbow, this upper arm is pulling towards that Cody's Tramp stamp right here, and not thinking about how far back can you go. Now again, if your goal is rear delts, if your goal is upper back, pulling back as far as you can is fine. But if the goal is lats, everything kind of has to come and finish this direction. And lastly, if we're focusing more on, so again, for Cody's lat here, you can see obviously a lot of the fibers go and attach down here, but as I feel here, I can actually feel obviously some of the fibers actually come across and attach. They go right over top of his erectors here and attach this direction. So again, if he's finishing a row, and arguably you want to bias finishing a row or finishing a pull down, how could I maybe bias these more than these fibers? The only thing I say that might have a little bit of a difference is really the intent of finishing down and not so much around, right? So if I'm finishing a row and he really feels like he's trying to pull around without rotating his whole torso, if he's trying to pull around and pull this way, maybe these upper lat fibers are doing a little bit more work. And if he's doing a pull down and focusing on driving his elbow, I always say think about driving your elbow to your hip, your elbow to the floor, almost kind of like a little crunchy down type motion. Maybe this will bias those fibers a little bit more. So back to my little drawing here, realize again, as far as to start almost any motion, again, whether it's a pull down or whether it's a row, you know, I think the real focus should be make sure your lat's working and not this other stuff. And again, as this upper arm comes down in here to finish, realize again, if you're trying to pull your upper arm around a little bit more, you can see hopefully this makes sense how this could pull this direction a little bit more. These upper fibers here can arguably do a little bit more of this. Whereas if I focus on my upper arm and my elbow pulling down, arguably these can have a little bit more of that component. Now again, all this comes back to actual change in your physique development. Have I ever seen someone use that tip that I gave and say, oh, I'm gonna finish with this around and I'm gonna finish with this down. Someone says, I'm gonna finish everything down. All of a sudden, just their lower lat gets huge and these don't develop. I've never actually seen it happen. So again, the reality is, the sad take home of this story is, I don't really think you can target your lower lats. At best, I think you can just work your lats a little bit more than some of this other stuff up here. Some of this Terry stuff, some of this rotator cuff junk, some of this rear delt stuff right in here. If you develop and can actually bias this to work more, I think most of that is actually determined a little bit more by genetics, muscle bellies, insertions, things like that. But again, it's not a bad thing as long as you manage your expectation. If you give those tips, I think they're worth messing around with. So it's worth finishing with this down component, maybe worth finishing with this around component. That's really the take home. For pull downs, maybe finish down if the goal is lats. If the goal is more kind of upper lats and you're doing a row, maybe finish a little bit more around. It's not a bad thing. It's not going to cause any problems. Is it going to have a drastic development difference? I don't think so. And if I didn't say at the beginning of the video, don't forget to like, subscribe, tell a friend who wants lower lats, and until the next one.